My name is Sallie Ann Robinson, the Gullah Cooking Diva. And presently, I am at my daughter-in-law house, Keisha, and her husband, my son, Jermaine. And I'm preparing this great meal. And for those of you who love to cook, or even if you don't, I promise you, you will enjoy doing this dish. And we're going to do some fried ribs, some sauteed cabbage, and the sweet potato in that bowl is going to be some sweet potato covered in some cinnamon and sugar combined together and baked. So sit back and relax and let's do it. Now, how do I break this rib down from this to a piece like this? And on the flip side of this rib, there are bones and there are sections. You will see there are sections, and that's where I'm going to start cutting. And what I like to do is cut in the center. That way you will have meat on both sides of the bone. Once I've cut the rib, I'm going to add the oil to preheat whilst I'm preparing the seasoning. So what I'll do is come over and add the oil. And I get asked, how much oil do you need? Well, one of the things is, when you're frying, you should have enough oil. You should have enough oil to fry. So normally I would add about a third oil to a skillet, basically because it will come to that point when you add the meat in it, oil rise. So you don't need half a pot of oil and you don't need less because it's either going to fry too hard are not enough. And that's the reason I use a third to help do this. Now, these beautiful ribs, what I'm going to do, some people like to take the seasoning, and the seasoning today is salt, black pepper, paprika, garlic powder, and this is powdered onion. You can, you don't have to add it, but I love some onions. So that's, and the flour. So my way of doing this to make it easy and to avoid, you know, throwing away a lot of seasoning when you put it on and not sure how much you have, take a Ziploc bag, take a brown paper bag, and add your flour. How much flour do you need? This is about 4 to 5 cup of self-rising flour. I know a lot of people like all-purpose flour. I like to fry with self-rising flour, basically because to me it adds an extra crispy that all-purpose doesn't. These 5 spices to me is all you really need to add to your meat cooking, because I like to keep it simple. I don't like to overpower my meat with too much spices. So my basic is salt. Remember, self-rising flour is also, you know, balanced. So how much salt? I'm just going to add a couple of great pinches here, about 4 of that. Pepper, how hot do you want it? So I will add a couple great pinches of that. Now you can always go back and add more, but the one thing is to first get in the amount you think you need. Paprika, I love when I'm frying, so I'm going to add quite a bit of that. My garlic, hey, you can't win for losing, but you're going to win every time you use garlic here. So I am hooked on garlic. And then onion powder, which adds that onion flavor. There. And I just take them all and combine them, and this balance it out. And what I'll do is check to see if I'm gonna add some more paprika because I like that color, okay? I try not to add too much salt to my diet or anyone's diet. And once I combine this, I sometime take a pinch and taste it. That tastes good to me. I do that because I want to add just the right amount versus not too much. So I'm going to wash my hand. Whilst the oil is heating, I have started to cut up a little cabbage here. This is part of the cabbage. So what I do when I get my cabbage is I peel off a couple of the first layers and you check it. Sometime it looks good, sometime it doesn't. And you just take that off and put it to the side. Now, being that I've cut most of that off, the heart of the cabbage, which is right here, you want to cut down and you want to get that piece out. That little piece right there, that kernel, that hard part right there. And here go another little piece here. If I had cut it even, I would have had it all. So there go the other part to that heart of the cabbage. Now, what do? I turn it over, cut it. You don't want too small of pieces. So, and this is the basic size when I peel it apart, because when you cook it, it's gonna actually shrink some. Now that I have that done, my oil is heating. And this is all preparation. Prepping for your meal really, really helps you as you cook. I have this purple onion here that will go in there. And I pretty much gonna make rings. You don't have to make rings. You can cut this onion up according to how you want it. But I'm just doing rings today. I'm going to add some red pepper. Do you need red pepper? No. But I'm adding it for color. So what I'm doing here, I've washed these vegetables. So know that before you cut and use your vegetable to actually cut them up. And that's enough. You don't really need a whole lot, but I always say, if you want more, add more. Now, let's check the oil. Let's see where we're going here. I do this a lot because I know heat when I'm cooking. I normally feel over the pan knowing that the oil is hot, but am I gonna check it? I'm gonna take the safest way to do this, a pinch of flour instead of water, because water and oil do not mix. And I will, right now this oil is not hot enough because the minute it hit it, it just started falling to the bottom. What I'm looking for, when I put that oil in there, it's gonna sizzle. So right now it is not sizzling enough to tell me that it's hot enough. So that's why I do test this all. And you do not wanna put meat in this oil until it's ready to fry. So it's getting there. So we are almost there. I have a sweet potato here. And what I'm about to do is to show you how I have already cut some up, but this is what I have to do in the beginning. And that is, I take a knife, I cut the ends off, and I'm pretty much going to peel it. Now, some would say, well, why don't you have a potato peeler? To me, I am old fashioned. I still use the knife. And basically, I want to get deep enough to where I'm taking that color there off of it. So that's why. And it's so much easier for me to take a knife and do this with this potato. Now be careful as you do this. I do want you to know that if you don't have good knife skill, please don't do it this way. So I just had a smaller knife to peel, but then I have a bigger knife to make my sizes. So I'm going to cut this in half, and then I'm going to take the half and cut them in half. What I pretty much do is cut it small enough, the size, a little nice bite size, easy. There you go. See, a nice bite size. So you can even cut it smaller. Always say, you know, it's yours. Make it the way you want. Now, let's go back to the oil because I do not want it. I do not want the oil too hot. So what I'm going to do is take another pinch of flour, and I can feel the heat even more now coming from the skillet. And the minute I drop it, it sizzles. That's telling me that it's ready. So what I do is I will come here, my seasoned flour. I will add pieces of ribs to it. And this also helps a lot when you're frying to keep things. About 4 or 5 pieces, sometimes 6, because that would be the basic amount you want to put in the size skillet. I shake it, and there goes some flour pooping out here. Come on, let's do this. You want to flour it well. Now, I'm just going to bring this over. I'm going to check my temperature, turn it down a little bit, because I don't want the oil to be too hot. I will shake, coat well, see? There we go. Adding this to the skillet and frying. You hear that great sound of it's cooking. And just move it around a little bit. Because the center of the skillet is actually the hottest, and it's where your meat starts to cook fastest. So when I put it on the outside, there we go. Watch that. You can start to smell the aroma of this rib frying, and it's like time to eat. And what I'll do is check as it browns. And as you can see, when I add those ribs in there, the oil rise. The oil rise. So if you had much more oil in there, it would actually come over the skillet, and you don't want that. So, and you just check and turn. How long, it actually depends on the thickness of the ribs. So you're cooking it at least a minute or two on each side to start with. And you turn. Sometime you'll turn these ribs back and forth, but you want it to get that nice brown color, and making sure that it is also done. So, and that's why I enjoy cooking, because I watch the texture. I love the smell, which is the aroma that it just gives out, saying, yes, she's in the kitchen cooking this great meal. I'm going to put a little oil. Now, the reason I'm adding a little oil is because I did not fry bacon to make the oil. A lot of time, it would be great if you want to add bacon. If you fry your bacon, remove it, and the oil that you have from the bacon, you actually keep in the pan. So being that I did not add bacon, because a lot of us are not pork eaters, we don't eat bacon. Sad but true, because of you. But I'm just gonna add enough oil in here to coat the bottom of this pan, okay? I don't need a whole lot. I don't want it too much oil. So I just add enough to coat the bottom of it. In the meantime, I'm going to go ahead and always check your meat as you go. Never take your attention off what you're doing. Even if it's 2, 3, or 4 things one time, but you have to be multitasked whilst you're at the stove cooking all these different ingredients here. So I'm just letting this heat because that's where we're going to add these great cabbage. And I love cabbage. We ate it, but not as much as we did collard greens. So my thing is, and you can take this. Some folks will run water after they cut it up. I like to wash it before, because then you have to put this cabbage with water on it into this hot oil. It actually pops, and it can actually harm you, the popping oil. Look at this. Nice ribs as we're cooking here. It starts to brown really, really good. And you just turn it so that it'll cook evenly on. And this little dark spot here is showing just the blood from the meat. Sometimes they pop up and that's all well and good. It shows nice freshness. What I'm going to do, because I have, it's starting to fry. And also, I put it in without having the water on it because I want it to actually fry a little. So I'm just going to add enough of this in there. Mm-hmm. You can hear it frying now. Actually, I pull it apart so it'll cook even better. The one thing about it, I like to pull it apart. I like to separate the cabbage pieces so you don't get big chunks, because in the center they actually are tight, much tighter than. There we go. Now, we're just going to add all of that. And we got that going. Yes. And what I'm doing here, this is going to cook down. That's another thing about cabbage. It's going to cook down. So, See, you can start seeing that color in there. And that's what I'm looking for, a little color here. There we go. Add some more. And some corn. I'm going to add this. What I'm going to do is bring over this, because this is what I'm going to add to my cabbage once it actually starts cooking. And you don't have to add these ingredients, because if you don't like onion or you don't like peppers, then you just add a little seasoning like salt and pepper, and then you just pre-fry it to the point. Here we go. You can hear that noise. There we go. It's frying. See there, it starts to change color. You get that clear color, that glycerin color there. And you just want it to fry. Don't rush it, basically, because you don't want to turn the heat up too high. And then it starts to burn. So, yes. So, but I'm going to add this as soon as this gives me a little more coloring. About now, I'm going to go ahead and add my onions. And like I say, you can add purple onion or you can add white onions. As little or as much as you want, because we know how much onion kicks in that flavor. You should always know that if you like something, then you want to add a little more to enhance. And that's like an onion and one whole purple onion and a half in this mixture here. Oh, you can start to smell it. And that color, that green and purple color coming together right now.
And I saute that a little bit. And now I'm just going to add in this red, some flavor. And one thing about food, and if you read recipes, you always know that they might be the writer's recipe or the cook's recipe, but you can always make it yours. So, and I'm just adding that. Oh, that's so nice. I love combining food for the flavor as well as the color, making everything so pretty and delicious. And it all turns out to be very tasty. The mouth starts to, you know, water for this great flavor you're bringing together right now. And here goes the rib is actually frying a little more. And since we have a few minutes on our hand, I've turned up the oven. And what I'm going to do is take this potato, which I have included in a much smaller, a bigger dish, because I have other potato cut. And here, all I did was to get I took my potatoes. In this dish here, I have a mixture of cinnamon and white sugar. Now, you can add brown sugar, you can add the dark one or the light one. And what I did is just sprinkled it over. Actually, took a piece of foil, cover it, put it in the oven on 350. In the process, it baked. And this is what I got right here. And it is so good. It's light. This is light. It's sweet and very tasty. You can make a whole lot of it. A little of it. And what I've done, you can see the sugar in there. The sweet potato is done. And this is so good. And it's easy. So you don't have to go out your way to make a great dish taste good, because like I always say, keeping it simple works perfectly well. I actually, once I took the brown sugar and covered it in foil, I put the oven on 350 and I pretty much let it bake until the potatoes are done. Now, a lot of times they will give me a time. Well, if you're a cook, I trust you. If you're checking your food, you want your sweet potato done. And the reason I'm saying that, I can't give you an exact time, because there are different size pieces in here, and that matters. I can tell you 30 minutes, but then some of the biggest pieces might not be as cooked. So what I do is tell you to stir it as you cook it, and then make sure I take a fork and check them. And see, forks go straight through. And oh man, they are so good. Nice good coloring pieces. So this is my potato, and I cooked that earlier because as we do this meal, the rest of the ribs and the cabbage, it's not gonna take as long to cook it. I have to get back to stirring my cabbage because I don't want it to stick. It's time for me to add some black pepper and salt and a little garlic. That's my garlic. Now, what I will do, also when you add salt to cabbage, it also draws the water out. When I season, I take a couple of good pinches and go around. I take black pepper, like I always say, it depends on how hot you want it. If you're a pepper person, just be careful, regardless. And then here goes some garlic. Do you need to add garlic? Well, I'm a garlic lover. I'm sure most of you are. And then All I'm doing is combining them, adding more flavor, seasoning it. Wow. Okay. That is good. Look at that color there. Look at this color. Yeah. Oh, and the flavor that goes with this. Now, I'm gonna add just a little bit of water because I want to make it softer. How much I'm gonna add. And if you're adding water to a hot pot, please add hot water. Cold water would only break it down where it has to start back up. So if you're adding hot water, you're actually keeping the balance of it and it continues to cook. My measurement for the water in the cabbage is actually going to be first, you want to add about a half a cup. About a half a cup. Okay, simmer. All right, add a little more. And then you just let this simmer. Will you need more seasoning? More likely because you added the water to it. And here we're just going to turn the rest of this ribs here. And let it cook. Once I cook this here, we're gonna eat because this is almost done. And the potatoes is done. And then we're gonna plate it and show you. And Tabitha, you get to eat some. Yes. Now, another question I get asked, how much do you cook this dish? Well, we grew up, we cooked all of our vegetable well. We never ate crunchy or raw vegetable other than carrots. And today, having a little crunch in your vegetable is really good. I mean, it's healthy. But I always say it's up to the individual and what you like. So if you like crunch, then you can actually stop and right here at this point. I'm just going to let it cook a little more for me. And being that I'm going to add another pinch of salt. Some more garlic. A little more pepper. That's about it. And let it cook for a few more minutes. Mmm, don't that look just delicious? Look at that rib. Mmm. Just make you want to bite into it, but it's too hot. So, the bigger piece I try to cook a little more because you want it done. A lot of time I will stick my fork in it and sit it back into the oil for a few more minutes. That way it's cooked thoroughly. Now for those of you who like a little pink, that's understood. But I just try to cook this to a point where I'm going to take that off. Turn around. Now I'm going to bring this delicious plate of ribs to the table. We're at the table, and this was a quick and easy dish. As you can see, it didn't take all day, and just smelling it lets you know that, you know, you're going to enjoy this. It's fun, it's delicious, and it's really belly filling. So if you don't want to be in the kitchen all day, you have a meat, you have vegetable, you have actually two vegetables, but one is a little sweeter, and this is how we bring food together. And this is what you call down home Gullah cooking.